Welcome to the Monocle Banking Podcast, a series curated by Monocle Solutions, where we balance the books in the dynamic world of finance. As always, I'm your host, Michael Avery, and today we're talking about global banking, but specifically what's going on in the US and the closure of the Federal Reserve's Bank Term Funding Program, the BTFP. And that's certainly sparking some fears in the market about the stability of the banking system. With the end of this program, coupled with high interest rates and vulnerabilities in what we're seeing in commercial real estate loans over in the US, economists are warning of potential turmoil ahead. But what exactly are the risks and how worried should we be? Join us as we unravel the intricacies of the US banking sector, from the rise of problem banks to the resurgence of zombie banks that continue to operate despite being insolvent. Well, my guest this week is David Buckham, CEO of Monocle Solutions. And David, this is one of those moments, great to have you on the podcast, firstly, where you wrote about this in Why Banks Fail. And it's one of those I told you so moments. So I've got to just kind of tip the cap to you, because I think you had in the book concerns raised about what the Fed was missing in its stress test. So firstly, welcome. Take us back to the Fed stress test days and why the Fed was missing some key systemic risks under the surface in the US regional banks.
So thank you, Michael, for the intro. I really appreciate it, although I'm sometimes not that happy when I'm right. This one is not looking so good. So I'm going to take you back to March of 2023. Silicon Valley Bank blows up because there are sudden raft of withdrawals, electronic withdrawals that take place that make the bank illiquid, and the Federal Reserve and the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation have to step in and insure all deposits, even if they're over $250,000. So there's bank runs across the country, and ultimately three banks go down in a space of a couple of weeks. Fast forward to June, which is when the Federal Reserve runs its annual stress test under the Dodd-Frank Act, which was passed as a result of the financial crisis. And the annual stress test comes back with flying colors. The banking system in the US is in great shape, which was a massive red flag. On closer analysis, you realize that the Fed stress test only applies to banks with over $250 billion of assets because of a rollback in 2018 under the Trump administration, where the limit for inclusion in the stress test went from $50 billion of assets to $250 billion of assets. So that's the first problem. Only 23 banks in the end were included in a stress test of the entire U.S. banking system, where there are 4,500 banks. One of the major stresses in the June stress test is that there's a massive decline in the value of commercial property of 40% or 38%, which is a good stress in the sense that it was happening and it was perceivable that that could happen.
There was a high likelihood, in fact, yeah.
And it's transpired. It is continuing to transpire. But what they don't tell you is that 80% of those assets are not held on the balance sheets of those 23 banks.
They in the other banks, 4,000 and whatever.
They're in the other banks. So that's problem number one. So 80% of the risk to the U.S. banking system is not accounted for in the official Federal Reserve's annual stress test. Problem number one. Problem number two is that the stress that they apply, their severe stress, which is called by Financial Times doomsday stress test. And remember, it's an annual stress test. In this doomsday stress test, the U.S. economy goes into recession, thereby forcing the U.S. Fed to instantaneously or suddenly, within this hypothetical stress test, drop interest rates to zero to save the U.S. economy from cataclysmic outcomes. And this is extremely disingenuous for many reasons. The U.S. Fed is the same institution that sets interest rates, right? So they set the federal funds rate. They had just finished raising rates 11 times.
Yeah.
So why would they, in the next 12 months, make the rate zero? Even in the best case scenario for inflation, you wouldn't have declined rates ever in the history of mankind instantaneously after 11 raises to zero. What they did inadvertently, maybe it wasn't that inadvertent, was they eliminated another problem that they had, which was that the losses on the bond portfolios that were held by banks. So banks had, you know, so much excess cash that had been deposited with them because there was so much excess dollars.
Through the QE period.
So quantitative easing had increased money supply by tenfold from 2007 to 2022. Tenfold more money. It was accelerated massively during COVID as well, as a kind of COVID relief, economic relief. So you have 10 times more money in circulation, and people deposited that money. They don't hide it under their beds. They deposit it at banks. Banks don't know what to do with that money because they don't want to lend because they're risk averse. So those deposits, you need to balance the balance sheet. So banks have gone ahead in the US and bought government bonds, but they bought them when they were at 0% interest rates. As the Fed finally reacted to inflation after being very slow to the task.
Team transitory was soundly beaten.
Yeah, transitory narrative was wrong. And Powell eventually raises interest rates. Only in March of 2022 does he raise interest rates after having a lot of evidence of inflation. 11 times he raises interest rates, which means that bond values, which move in an inverse manner to interest rates, obviously decline in value. So on the balance sheet of banks like Bank of America, there was $100 billion.
Unrealized losses.
Now, if you're a CFA candidate, chartered financial analyst, or if you're anybody in the Western world other than in America, you would treat those unrealized losses either as an impact on your income statement or as an impact on your balance sheet, but not in America under the mixed measurement approach.
Yeah.
So that means they don't have to recognize those unrealized losses unless, like SVB, you have withdrawals and you need to top up with cash and you have to sell your bonds, which they did, and they made a $1.9 billion loss on $20 billion of bonds, which is what killed them when they announced that.
And I mean, to the outsider looking at that, if you want to do a stress test for a doomsday scenario, the doomsday scenario that you should also be modeling is a doomsday scenario where rates have to stay higher for longer, where inflation is stickier than anticipated,
right,
and therefore causing more pain,
right,
prolonged pain in the bond market. And so for banks to have to respond in that environment, they might have to realize some of those losses. So I think it was quite curious that this was kind of the base case scenario.
One would almost think that it was an outcome that they wished the stress test to have, which was that it resulted in them being able to say that the U.S. banking system is resilient. It came out in a policy statement. An interesting fact, Michael, a few weeks after SVB blew up, there was a change in a policy statement on the Fed's website, which said that the U.S. banking system is strong and resilient. Only last week, with this New York Community Bank Corp almost failing, did they take that policy statement off their website.
Oh, that's very interesting. Has that been removed?
It's been removed. So throughout 2023 until now, in March 24, following three of the largest four failures in the U.S. banking system, only now did they finally remove a policy statement saying that the U.S. banking system is strong and resilient.
I'm slack-jawed, I mean, this is the world's reserve bank, effectively. The Fed sets the policy rate for the rest of the world against which every asset on earth is priced,
right? So, I mean, we experience inflation because of mistakes made in the U.S. by the U.S. Fed, which also sets the banking laws for the U.S. banks, and which also ran a disingenuous, to say the least, stress test. Because remember, U.S. banks have, the large banks have plenty of capital, especially the 23 that they were testing, to absorb a commercial property crisis. The problem is not capital. The problem is that when you have withdrawals, you need to make cash come from somewhere. And so you have to sell your bonds at a loss. And that's the risk that they didn't test. now, a year later.
So what we had in response then, March 2023, we're now March 2024, beware the Ides of March. It always seems to happen at this time of year. But we had the Federal Reserve's Bank Term Funding Program implemented as some kind of lifeline to undergird the stability of these banks who needed access to capital. How was that structured? And it's now come to an end.
Well, yes, it's structured in a way that is crazy, Michael, is basically the Federal Reserve, for any qualifying bank, which is every bank that's deposit-taking, will take on any asset that's a government bond or a mortgage-backed security, which is actual value might be lower than its face value. They'll take it at face value on a $1 for $1 basis, and they will pay a rate, which is determined by, it's a fairly complex rate. It's called an index swap rate.
Right.
That index swap rate is quite an attractive rate, and it's determined by market forces. And the problem has become of recent time, over the last couple of months, but particularly since November, that the index swap rate is now in excess of the interest on reserve balance rate. So there's a concept, and I know we're getting very technical, where banks have required reserves as per capital rules that they have to put with the Federal Reserve. But because of the excess liquidity that was created by quantitative easing, since 2008, there's so much excess reserve. To give you an example, in 2007, there was $100 billion of required reserves and very little, like $43 billion of excess reserves. Whereas in 2012, there was $100 and something billion of required reserves in the U.S. banking system, and $1.5 trillion of excess reserves.
Wow.
So it's called interest on reserve balances. And the interest on reserve balances is determined by a rule, which changes frequently because they can't get it right, which is to put a floor in. It's a Milton Friedman idea, to put a floor rate in to ensure that even though you're printing lots of money where you're creating a lot of excess, you're still able to get traders from banks to trade with each other in the interbank market within the range of the Federal Reserve's FOMC, the Federal Open Market
Committee.
They set the federal funds rate as a range of 25 basis points. So to get people to trade in that range on the interbank market, on the overnight market, in the three-month direct open window market, they have to set a lower limit for excess reserves, which are huge. And when the rate that you can get on the bank term funding program, which was set up just to after SVB, is higher, then you can make free money.
So banks start gaming the system.
Hugely. So you can see it in the numbers. The numbers go from, you know, 100 billion to 300 billion over the last few months. So the Fed has a scenario in which a trader at a bank can take an asset that's worth 80 cents on the dollar, sell it to the Reserve Bank for 100 cents on the dollar, get a higher rate than they would get with excess cash, then take the excess cash and
book that as a profit.
Book that as a profit instantaneously.
But I mean, this is taking the idea from the global financial crisis where the U.S. government basically stepped in and socialized the losses and privatized a lot of the gains to an altogether different level.
It's something even for someone as battle-hardened as me and as wary of the Fed as me, there's other things that have blown my mind as well. I mean, this is a particularly bad one. So it happens to be actually March the 11th as we speak, I think.
Yeah, yeah. So it's come to an end.
Today is the day it ends. Yeah.
As we speak. And then I guess no surprise that the Fed looking at this wasn't going to extend.
Could not because of the arbitrage.
But because of that arbitrage. But equally, you know, what does that mean in terms of introducing new risk into the U.S. banking system?
So it's so interesting, Michael, is that some of the regular publications such as The Economist, The FT, The New York Times, there's like quite an absence of commentary that's critical of the situation, whereas there are some Cassandras out there that are very concerned. I would say that I am very concerned because the lifeline, which was the way to preserve the U.S. banking system from extreme risk, which was bank run after bank run after bank run, especially in a banking system which there's far too many banks, regional banks, is the risk has increased massively. I mean, I can give you an example. The FDIC, which is the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation, has created a list of risky banks, which is their own view, which is separate and independent from the Federal Reserve's view. They have increased in the last 2 months the number of banks on that list from 44 to 52, of which New York Community Bancorp was not on it.
Wow. Could you question how many others are out there that aren't on these lists?
Yeah. So they're saying that the total asset value of those 52 banks, which is like an 18% increase in bank riskiness, is only $66 billion. But New York Community Bancorp had an assets of over $100 billion. So that's just one bank that probably most people in our audience have never heard of.
What happened with New York Community Bancorp? Because if you look at the actors now that have stepped in to try and salvage the situation, you've got a former Secretary of the Treasury, Steve Mnuchin, who has questionable involvement here. What initially happened? I was watching the screens last week on my Bloomberg terminal as the U.S. market opened. You know, here's this bank, as you say, around $100 billion in assets. Mm-mm. Dropping 40% in a matter of minutes.
And then more.
But it then ended up on the day after news of $1 billion capital, I think it was a rights issue or capital raise. What happened there?
So, I mean, this is one of those amazing stories of unintended consequences is you take a perfectly normal bank, right, which then goes and buys Signature Bank. Right. So Signature Bank, remember, was the bank that failed. And interestingly, I think Barney Frank of the Dodd-Frank Act was one of the directors of Signature Bank.
So you can't make this stuff up.
You can't make it up, right? So Signature Bank was bought out by New York Community Bancorp. And you have to ask yourself the question, why would New York Community Bancorp, which is a bank that mainly is involved in financing real estate in New York, and New York in 2019 changed the law for rent control to make New York more affordable and more, you could say, less capitalist and more communist. So you can't adjust the rental rates on these buildings which you financed. So your chance of having a failure on a book of buildings in New York City is quite high. And then that same bank makes the decision to buy Signature Bank out of failure at the behest, you would guess, of the New York Fed, to create a bank that now has over $100 billion of assets, which is now facing enormous losses because they announced that they weren't that profitable, which was obviously not a surprise. So, well, it was a surprise to some because there was a 40% decline in equity. So then Steve Mnuchin and his investment company step in. Now, remember, Steve Mnuchin was a Goldman Sachs executive. And there's a long history of the Fed and the U.S. Treasury employing ex-Goldman Sachs executives.
Their nickname on Wall Street is Government Sachs for a reason.
Right. Hank Paulson would be a very good example. Remember the TARP program that he wrote on three pages and insulted, you know, here he went to Congress to ask for $700 billion bailout on three pages. I don't know if you remember that story. So a long history of Goldman Sachs executives that then become very powerful people in the Fed and in government and in the U.S. Treasury. And by the way, there's also a big overlap between the personnel that sit on the FOMC and who are also members of the U.S. Treasury. So Steve Mnuchin puts $1 billion in. That's to buy equity at a 38% discount to the then prevailing price and then immediately make several hundred million dollars in profit. So that concerns me. When we speak about moral hazard, we often speak about it in a very theoretical,
abstract way. I mean, here it is staring at us in the face.
Yeah. So it concerns me that this is where we're at right now, where this organization's putting things on their website like bank resilience. They put that on their website a few weeks after three of the largest four bank failures in US history. So I believe that in the current environment, we need to be concerned. It is without any doubt that I say there will be more bank failures in the US this year.
Powell has, in his testimony before the Banking Senate Committee last week, almost acknowledged that there'll be a few and, you know, this is just where we are in the cycle. And so he's basically trying to signal that his tolerance would be for one or two banks to hit the wall. How much deeper do you think this runs in terms of the potential for more systemic risk that Powell is now underplaying in his testimony before the Senate Banking Committee?
To the extent that I don't know what goes on in Jerome Powell's mind, but I'm fairly certain of a few things. The first is that we have asset bubbles throughout the U.S. system. The NASDAQ, the S&P 500, Bitcoin.
NVIDIA. Trading like a penny stock, even though it's now the third or fourth largest company in the world.
Yes, we're talking about Apple, NVIDIA. I mean, these are $3 and $2 trillion companies. U.S. debt, government debt, has ballooned. Private sector debt, which is shadow banking debt, has ballooned to $1.7 trillion. And you've got property values that are way overvalued throughout the U.S. So you've got a combination of, and you've got U.S. employment at an all-time low, and inflation slightly sticky. So in my view, there's got to be some kind of reckoning in which the prices come down because they are now trading at price earnings multiples that are outside of the long run range. Prices of assets such as Bitcoin continue to confound me. That's gone from a $700 billion asset to a $1.5 trillion asset. And it's really a bunch of numbers in private wallets.
The narrative, again, is it drives the price as much as QE also drives the price. And I've seen some very interesting graphs overlaying the amount of excess liquidity, M1, M2, M3 money supply in markets with the price of Bitcoin. They correlate quite well.
Highly correlated.
But then we saw the ETF launch earlier this year that seemed to drive some institutional flows and also provide a bit more hype. And it's incredible how when there's a crypto winter, so to speak, you don't hear from any of the exchanges. Now, all of a sudden, they want to be everywhere. Everyone's talking about halving dates and all kinds of newfangled theories. And I'm with you on that one. I still can't make head or tail of it. And I think it can come down to next to nothing just as quickly as it went up. But I want to stay with the New York Community Bank and how effective a capital raise can be when the underlying stress is defaults on credit cards, commercial real estate loans that will potentially be underwater and go bad. How do you view the effectiveness of a capital raising initiative in addressing those underlying vulnerabilities? It looks to me like you're putting a Band-Aid on a gaping wound.
I think the capital raise was a signal to the market, and I think I'm almost scared to say what I think will happen because it's right now, which could happen in the next few days. Things could change. But the capital raise appeared to improve the share price. The share price has got nothing to do with the bank's liquidity. So the bank is reasonably liquid, but they've had an erosion of capital by taking on an income statement loss, which was they lost money on their income statement. They had negative profit. So it's a slightly different scenario to SVB in that the liquidity here is not the issue. It's the share price. And the share price went down because of a belief that this bank will continue to make losses. So the capital raise was a signal that some clever people out there think otherwise and that they can buffer up the capital and absorb future losses on an annual basis. It's only when the depositors start withdrawing their funds that you're going to have a liquidity crisis.
Yeah.
And thus far, for reasons that I don't fully understand, in SVB's case, you had a major rush of deposits pulling out of SVB very quickly, electronically, driven mainly by VC. By venture capitalists.
Which had large deposits.
And which are very large deposits.
It takes four or five very large deposits to then
bam, you're out.
Mushroom.
$40 billion in a day. Whereas New York Community Bank Corp has got a far more diversified deposits base. Mm. And also, until today, they still have access to the bank term funding program. tomorrow they don't. So I think it's kind of watch the space.
And again, if you look at the underlying set of vulnerabilities, I don't see anything changing in terms of interest rates, with the messaging from Powell being that we saw the jobs numbers last week that they were quite good, even though the unemployment rate is rising marginally. Inflation, oil price is still well in the range of $80. All of those pressures are there to support a widely held theory, actually, that we might see a double dip in terms of inflation going up, coming back down, and then going back up again. And given that Powell had so much egg on his face with Team Transitory and getting it so badly wrong, the last thing he wants to do now is start cutting rates and we see inflation spiking again. I mean, his credibility is already, in my opinion, shredded. It'll be absolutely beyond
eviscerated
after that. So the risks are still massive.
I think so. I mean, I've said this many times. You just need to look at the data from 1979 through 1982-83 to see that when you have inflation, it's not you have inflation, the Federal Reserve raises rates, then inflation comes down, and then rates come down. It's like a dance that takes place. There were several peaks in the 1980s, in the early 1980s, of inflation. Now, I'm not convinced that we'll see that kind of volatility of inflation. I'm 100% convinced that rates won't go back to zero in the next 10 years. I just can't see that. They can't do that. The system is already broken. So I don't think the first time that they might raise rates would be in June. Decrease rates would be in June. But I suspect that something will occur before then, which will cause them to keep rates in June at the level that they're at.
I want to come back to the testimony that Jay Powell made last week, and I've got a note here. And he was saying that the Fed is looking at innovative approaches with regards to liquidity rules after what we saw in March 2023 with the sudden exodus of some banks' deposit bases. And as for commercial real estate, he said the Fed's just talking with the banks to make sure they're on top of potential losses. It doesn't sound like very much there, but very much echoing what Treasury Secretary Janet Yellen's take was, is that there'll be some failures, but the situation is manageable. What do you think innovative approaches with regards to liquidity rules could mean? Because there wasn't much else in terms of detail put on the table.
They've got quite, they're in a, I mean, imagine being in a building which is like on fire, and you spent the last 15 years since the 2007-2008 financial crisis trying to convince people that you know what you're doing. The Federal Reserve has got very used to muting the, like, big finger on the mute button and just going, it's going to be okay. You know, so they've printed money. I mean, Janet Yellen was at the helm when quantitative easing went from, like, open market operator when it went, like, ballistic. So in Europe, we have rules called LCR and NSFR, and in South Africa, we have these rules. I'm not a huge fan of either of the rules, but it's like a basic liquidity set of rules, which only 23 banks in the United States are having to meet because they're within that range of $250 billion up. So one of the innovative things that they could do is to include more banks within that rule, which the Republicans in a Congress that's very divided, you know, might go against. It's not pro-business. It's not pro-banking. It's a big drag on banking to create these qualifying liquid stores of money that's just in case.
Sterilize that happen.
Yeah, yeah. So I'm not sure is the answer. I mean,
there's a lot of pushback against Basel III Endgame.
Yeah.
And, you know, he's taken a lot of heat as Powell in being a little bit too lax and too light on the banks.
Yeah.
You know, we've given him a lot of flack about the stress test, and he needs to be seen to be doing something here.
Yeah. I mean, it's, the easy way out is exactly what they're doing, is to say this is all in the normal course of business. Don't worry about it. The stress test for me was a cause of great insight for me just how deliberately disingenuous. So now I've used the word deliberate. It seems deliberate to me when they put on their website a few weeks after SVB that the U.S. banking system is sound and resilient. It's completely contradictory to what has just occurred. So, yeah, I mean, as I've put it in Why Banks Fail, we need to do something. The first thing to do would be to have an independent, that you can't mark your own homework.
Yeah. And what worries, again, when you overlay the politics of what's going on in the U.S. on this is, and we saw it during the global financial crisis, there was a woman by the name of Roberta Achtenberg who was waving a big stick at the banks, to ensure that more minorities in America get access to the American dream, blacks, Hispanics, other minority groups. And so the banks are very creative with coming up with those ninja loans, no income, no asset, no job, at a 0% or even minus, and then it would re-rate after 2 years. Now we're seeing, again, under a Democratic government, artificially capping what you can charge on interest. And, you know, these political interferences, overtly political in what should be one of the world's true free markets, again, is worrying. And who knows what might happen between Trump and Biden later this year and what might be rolled back. Coming back to your book, though, in terms of a solution, you mentioned independence as one. Surely there needs to be a greater and stricter policing and regulation of this revolving door between regulators into the private sector, into government, into regulatory officers. I mean, the Stephen Mnuchin story is outrageous.
I think it is. There is no law against making profit on an investment. So some people would argue you're not a true capitalist, David, if you're not allowing Steve Mnuchin to make some money.
With very unique insider information and access.
That not- we need to acknowledge he may or may not have had inside information. You know, we need to just accept that he's just a really smart guy. You know, I'm not sure how much smarter he is than...
It's amazing how many smart politicians there are.
It is kind of amazing. It must really annoy the liberal democratic left-wing people, which causes even more disruption and causes even a greater divide. There is a point I'd like to make, though, to do with that woman that you speak of waving that big stick. There is a problem in America. A real social problem in that there are food deserts in America. People have a problem with access to food of any sort, and healthy food especially, because of concentration in cities. And it's the same, there are banking deserts. There are fewer, these banks are not profitable. These 4,500 banks are very small community banks, and they're closing their branches. So people are going from, you know, the restaurant that they run and driving 50 miles to deposit cash, you know, and very inefficient banking. So America is way behind, barring, you know, Bank of America and Wells Fargo. The average local American bank is similar to a bank in the 1960s in South Africa.
Wow.
I know that sounds crazy, but it's true.
And just last month, the IMF published a paper on emerging markets. I think it should be looking more closely at the US and some developed markets, but on the rise of zombie banks that we're seeing systemically around the world, and some being propped up for political reasons because they're strategically SIFIs in those markets. Some in Africa were mentioned, particularly what's going on in China was mentioned. A very interesting working note from the IMF. So when you see papers like this coming out, you realize that the risk is bubbling to the surface globally and people are concerned about this.
China especially.
Especially in China, and I think we need to revisit China, given what we've seen happen there over the last few months. And some support, there seems to be a managed right-sizing of the Chinese property market, and one wonders how that might play out. But David, just as a final thought and before we wrap up, it's very difficult to say exactly how this ends, but what is the implication for us here in South Africa, for our banking system? We again seem to be fairly well insulated and not overly at risk here in a US-style banking crisis spilling over into South Africa's banks.
Yes, we are reasonably immune to a banking crisis in the US. The most likely scenario over the medium term would be that the US, which I believe has got a variety of asset bubbles embedded within its economy, starts to experience some pain. They're coming off a very, very strong unemployment figure. So there's quite a long road, which means that rates should come down, which means that rates in South Africa should come down because we'll move in lockstep, maybe a month or two behind, and which means that the rand should stay stable, in my opinion, so long as we don't have some kind of major political upheaval. I just saw a report this morning that's predicting the ANC only gets 40%.
MK starting to make some significant inroads at by-election and in polls.
Yeah, Yeah, it looks very complex, the outcome in South Africa politically. But let's say that things don't go horrifically bad for us this year. There's no reason why the rand shouldn't stay stable. We've still got positive growth, albeit almost nothing. I always say this. I find it amazing that we still have positive growth, given the challenges we face, which is very just shows the resilience of this economy.
Yeah.
But I think what we could see is our own local rates being lowered, which should compress bank profits, but be good for our economy.
Yeah, and at this stage in the cycle, given what we're seeing in some of the earnings, those non-performing loans are now starting to come through a little bit more forcefully. The banks certainly benefited in the early stage of the rate hiking cycle.
Yeah.
And I just think it'll be a net benefit, positive for the South African economy when we start to see rates come down, because it's been an absolute theme in the SA Inc. stocks and the CEOs at Motus and Bidvest that I interviewed last week, saying that the cost of funding and cost of capital is really putting a handbrake on growth and their ability to grow any more aggressively in South Africa. So that's very important. David, always a great pleasure chatting to you
here in
your office at the Mark in Sandton, and we'll certainly catch up soon. And I believe you're working on another book.
Yes.
So we'll have some follow-up.
We have a lot of words, but we're not near to publication.
Well, I'm looking forward to that one and how it connects all the dots to build a new map, so to speak, if you will, into this world of ESG, climate finance, electric vehicles, all of those. I'm just giving our listeners a little teaser there. David Buckham, CEO of Monocle
Thank Solutions. Thank you so much, Michael. I loved it.
Before we go, I'd just like to extend our gratitude to our growing audience for tuning in. Remember, you can find us on all good podcast platforms. Thanks for listening. Until next time, don't forget to subscribe.